Thank you very much for coming out tonight to Japan Night in New York City. Thanks a lot. We're here in part to celebrate the launch of this publication, which is called Monkey Business, New Writing from Japan. The inaugural issue was published last year. It's the English language edition of an acclaimed literary magazine from Japan. Features a number of extraordinary authors. If you're interested in what's happening in Japan today in literature, on top of course the pillar of Haruki Murakami, there are numerous other names in here, and there's even a manga at the center of the publication that's a Japanese graphic storytelling. So this publication will be available, is available just outside the doors this evening. The authors who are in this publication will be on stage tonight, some of them, and they will be happy to meet you and sign some copies this evening before you head home. So this is the publication I wanted to highlight here at the beginning of the show. My name is Roland Kelts. I'm the author of a book called Japan America. I divide my time between Tokyo and New York City. And as some of you know, this has been a relatively tough year for Japan, owing to what happened last March and ongoing challenges faced by the country. So I thought it would be a great idea to come to my other hometown and celebrate Japanese culture through music and literature and exchange, open exchange. I want to thank my friend Amanda Stern. She is the host of probably the most popular reading series in New York City, which is called the Happy Ending Reading Series. Amanda's a good friend of mine, and she helped set this up here at Joe's Pub this evening. Of course, I want to thank the folks here at Joe's Pub who've been really supportive and enthusiastic. The Nippon Foundation, which through their generosity provided the support for these publications and for these events here in New York. And of course, my dear friends with whom I'm involved on this project, Motoyuki Shibata and Ted Goosen, who are the founders and editors of Monkey Business in English and in Japanese. And Bridget Hughes and Anne McPeak from Public Space, which is the Brooklyn-based literary magazine that is co-publishing the Monkey Business Journal here in the United States. All good friends of mine, and this has been a special opportunity for me. I'm listed as a contributing editor, but in reality I'm more like a facilitator or a bridge, if you will, a metaphorical bridge. Sometimes it feels physical with all those flights, but technically a metaphorical bridge to help bring these two countries together and bring these people out on stage. So I'm not going to go on much longer. You have a whole list of wonderful people who are coming up on stage tonight, reading poetry, reading stories, and also engaging in conversation with you. And we have a fantastic band. They're called Neo Blues Maki. And as the name suggests, it's an incredible blend of Japanese soul, or soulful singing, otherwise known in Japanese as enka. It's a traditional style of Japanese singing. Blending that with a different kind of soul from the US and other parts of the world. And without further ado, here is Neo Blues Maki. Thanks.
for the lack of symmetry. The Monkey Business Manifesto. Monkey Business is a newly founded journal of new writing from Japan and abroad, with a few not so new works strategically slipped in. We offer nothing in the way of a concept or lifestyle aimed at a particular age bracket or social group, no useful information to help you get ahead. And we utterly lack that noble desire to provide a sanctuary from the whirl of daily life. If you gain any of these benefits, so much the better, but they are not our goals. Neither, we must add, do we have a radical agenda. Our intent is not to attack the system, whether it be artistic, political, or social. In fact, we aren't out to pick a fight with anyone, right or left, old or young, conservative or radical. Our inspiration for the name Monkey Business is that immortal Chuck Berry tune, where he rattles off like a machine gun. Same thing every day, getting up, going to school, the need for me to complain, objections overruled. Too much monkey business, too much monkey business, too much monkey business for me to be involved in. No other world that I know deals with the aggravations we face every day so straightforwardly and with such liberating humor. That is the guiding star we follow on our journey.
So then, like Moto and I decided to create an annual English version in the same spirit. We selected the most suitable pieces from the first year or so and then set about translating them with not a little help from our friends. And we've done now two volumes, one issue last year and the second issue this year. And both of them are available.
That's it.
And now we're going to start with some of the readings for the Japanese writers who've been invited. And the first one is Masatsugu Ono.
Thank you.
And yeah, we'll be back. Ono-san will now appear from this little black door. Here he is. The monkey brought bananas. So the way we're going to work this is Ono-san will read. It's a new work, which we've just translated in the last couple of weeks. And he'll read a section. I'll read the English translation, and we'll do that back and forth. There'll be three sections in all.
大きな音。おばあちゃんの目には縫い針が刺さったままだ。繕っても繕っても繕った縞。お父さんのズボンの膝のところを修繕していると気に、その大きな音が鳴ったのだ。通したいとピンと引っ張り上げようとした手が弾みで跳ね上がり、針山よりも柔らかい眼球の中へ針がプスッと落ち着いた。そのせいでおばあちゃんが死んだのか、それとも実際の死因はその音なのか、私たちには分からない。その瞬間を見たわけではなかった。 だから、おばあちゃんの針が入っていない方の目から流れた涙が、もう片方の目を貫いた痛みによるものなのか。お父さんのズボンを最後まで直すことができなかった恨みによるものなのか。それとも墓に入ることもできず、目に縫い針が刺さったままの状態で、死後を過ごさなければならないことの悲しみによるものなのか。私たちに分かるはずもなかった。祖父からお父さんの声が聞こえた。怒っているようにも泣いているようにも聞こえる。お父さんは私たちを探しているみたいだった。
The name of the story is The Great Noise. The needle was still stuck there in Grandma's eye. The blast of sound had come when Grandma was once again mending the knees of Father's pants, which kept fraying no matter how often she fixed them. She was pulling the needle up through the cloth when it hit, and the impact made her hand jump. The needle had found a place even softer than the pinhole, one of her eyeballs. Whether the needle killed her, or it was the sound that did it, we don't know. We didn't see actually happen. There was no way, therefore, for us to know whether the tears flowing from Grandma's undamaged eye came from the pain emanating from the other one, or from the bitterness she felt at having to leave her son's pants unmended, or from her sadness at having to greet the afterlife without the comfort of a tomb and with an eye skewered by a sewing needle. We heard Father's voice outside. He sounded angry. Then again, he could have been crying. Apparently, he was looking for us.
井戸の中をお母さんが覗き込んでいた。お父さんとお母さんが喧嘩をしていたのは知っていた。お母さんのお腹の中の子供がいなくなってしまったことをお父さんは怒っていた。私たちもその子に会うのをすごく楽しみにしていたから、お父さんの気持ちが分かるような気がした。あなたたちの代わりに消えてしまったのよ。だからしっかり生きなくてはいけないのよ。そうお母さんは井戸を覗き込むようになる前に私たちに言った。不思議な物言いだった。ある日私たちは叫んだ。私たちの代わりに生きてくれたらよかったのに。多分お母さんが井戸を覗き込むようになったのはそれからすぐのことだ。お母さんは自分の目が見ているものが信じられなかった。それでお母さんは自分が一番見慣れているものを見つめて疑いの雲を追い払おうとしたのだ。お母さんはとっても綺麗だった。私たちがその子供だからそういうのではない、お父さんだっていつもそう言っていた。それで私たちの頬を撫でながら、お前たちはお母さんにそっくりだと嬉しそうに笑った。でもそのお母さんが私たちのお母さんなのか、お父さんのお母さんなのか、その時はよくわからなかった。
Mother was Mother was peering into the well. We knew that father and mother had been arguing. Father was angry because the baby in mother's belly had disappeared. We kind of sympathized since we were also really looking forward to the baby. The baby disappeared in your place, mother had told us before she took to looking down the well. So you must live as fully as you can. Strange thing to say. At last we shouted, we wish the baby had lived in our place. I think it was right after this that mother's fascination with the well began. She couldn't believe what was before her eyes, so she tried to drive the cloud of doubt away by fixing on that which was most familiar. Mother was beautiful. We aren't saying this because we are children. Father always said it too. He would stroke our cheeks and tell us we were made in mother's image. At the time, we weren't sure though whether he meant our mother or his mother.
お父さんのお母さんの目には縫い針が刺さったままだったし、私たちのお母さんは井戸の中に自分の顔を探していた。お母さんがいくら溶け込んでも井戸の水に探しているものが映っているはずもなかった。いや、井戸の水は嘘なんてついていない。ありもしないものを映すことはできない。あの大きな音と一緒にお母さんの頭はどこかに消えていってしまった。あのいなくなった子供を探しに行ったのかもしれない。見つかるといいなと私たちは思う。どっちにしたってもう遅いけど、お父さんの声はだんだん大きくなっていった。
The needle stayed stuck in father's mother's eye. Our mother kept searching for her face down the well. No matter how hard she tried though, she never found what she was seeking reflected in that deep pool. Not that the well water was lying, it simply couldn't reflect what wasn't there. When a noise hit, our mother's head disappeared.Somewhere. Perhaps it had set off in search of the baby that had vanished from her belly. It'd be wonderful if it found the baby, we said to ourselves. But whatever the case, it was already too late. Father's voice was growing louder and louder. Thank you.
Thank you.
Houses. It's from an anthology dedicated, inspired by the writer Ray Bradbury. And so the larger story is a ghost story set in space, and this is one of the smaller ghost stories from it. I don't know any ghost stories on Said Slowly. I know stories about trolls. No, wait, I have one ghost story. It was a story that my great-grandmother told about the farm.Birkenma, where she grew up. The great room grew dark until all of them were only shadows, floating in shadow. Sissy wrapped an arm around Gwenda's waist. Outside the mullioned windows, the gardeners and the rose bushes disappeared. Now you saw a neat little farm and rocky fields, sloping up toward the twilight bulk of a coniferous forest. Yes, Mom said, exactly like that. I visited once when I was just a girl. The farm was in ruins. Now the world will have changed again. Maybe there is another farm, or maybe it is all for us now. She paused for a moment so they could all imagine it. My great-grandmother was a girl of 8 or 9. She went to school for part of the year. The rest of the year, she and her brothers and sisters did the work of the farm. My great-grandmother's work was to take the cows to a meadow where the pasturage was rich in clover. The cows were very big and she was very small, but they knew to come when she called them. In the evening, she brought them home again. The path went along a ridge. On the near side, she and her cows passed a closer meadow that her family did not use, even though the pasturage looked very fine to my great-grandmother. There was a brook down in the meadow and an old tree, a grand old man. There was a rock under the tree, a great slab that looked something like a table. Outside the windows of the English manor, a tree formed itself in a grassy, sunken meadow. My great-grandmother didn't like that meadow. Sometimes when she looked down, she saw people sitting all around the table that the rock made. They were eating and drinking. They wore old-fashioned clothing, the kind her own great-grandmother would have worn. She knew that they had been dead a very long time. One day my great-grandmother, her name was On too, I should have said that first, I suppose. One day On was leading her cows home along the ridge, and she looked down into the meadow. She saw the people eating and drinking at their table. And while she was looking down, they turned and looked at her. They began to wave at her, to beckon that she should come down and sit with them and eat and drink. But instead she turned away and went home and told her mother what had happened. And after that, her older brother, who was a very unimaginative boy, had the job of taking the cattle to the farm pasture. And I should say that that's actually a true ghost story that a friend of mine told me that I appropriated for the purpose of the story that I was writing. And I also hope that all of y'all pick up copies of Monkey Business, both the first and the second issue, because they are collections of absolutely extraordinary work. Thank you.
You know, you're just getting a taste of what we're doing with this Monkey Business thing. The idea is to somehow replicate what Monkey Business does in Japan. In Japan, Monkey Business is about 50% original writing in Japanese and about 50% translation. And in both cases, there's old stuff and new stuff. So what we're moving towards, this is the second issue that's just come out, what we're moving towards is something similar. So we have writers like Kelly Link and Stuart Dybeck and others who are being published in the Japanese Monkey Business in Shibata-san's translations, who are now contributing to the English Monkey Business. We're getting new original writing by people like Barry Yorkrow, who'll be reading in a second. And so, you know, we're kind of building momentum. We've got a nice group of translators. We've got two issues out now and a third in the planning stages. And so it's an attempt to create a kind of window on what's taking place in Japan now. When you see translated novels, usually the writer wrote it, it took a while to get it into print, and then the publisher has to make a decision, and then translator takes another year or two to translate it. And by the time it comes out in English, a significant time has elapsed. This way it can be fresh, you know, because it comes out in a literary magazine, there's no problem with permissions, we can get right into the translation. So the stuff is coming out within a year and a half or two of when it first appeared in the Japanese, which is pretty quick. And because things have changed so quickly in Japan, especially over the last 18 months, that makes it even more significant. And the new issue does deal with the events of 3/11 at the beginning. And so, again, you get a sense of how Japan is changing and how writers are adapting and leading that change. And one of the people who's most significant, I think, is Shibasaki-san. Tomoka Shibasaki is a new figure to us, but in Japan she's been writing for quite a long time. She's published many books. And what's coming out now in Monkey Business is the first translation, I'm sure, of many that will be produced through her work. So I introduce you to Tomoka Shibasaki. title of this work is The Glasses Thief.
This is a true story. メガネ強盗。1月1日の夕方、新幹線に乗るために品川駅に行った。新幹線乗り換えの改札を入り、トイレに行きかけたところで背中をつつかれた。振り返ると知らない男が立っている。50代くらい。背が高く、暗い色のジャケットにジャンパーを羽織っていた。メガネを貸してもらえませんか?と男が言った。私はその時メガネをかけていた。こういう時どちらかといえばつい貸してしまう性格なのだが、3年ほど前にメガネを貸してくださいと言っては奪う連続強盗事件のニュースがあったのを思い出し、いえちょっとと答えた。ダメですかねと男は重ねて聞く。はいと答えると男はそのまま行ってしまった。
The glasses thief.Late in the afternoon on New Year's Day, I was at Shinagawa Station to take the Shinkansen bullet train. I was on my way to Osaka to pay a holiday visit to my parents. I passed through the ticket gate and was heading for the restroom when someone tapped me on the shoulder. I turned around to find a man I'd never seen before. He was probably in his 50s, tall and wearing a dark jacket with a windbreaker slung over it. "Can I borrow your glasses?" he asked me.I had mine on at the time. Normally, I'm the type of person who complies with this type of request, but then I remembered a news item from roughly three years ago about a robber who asked passersby if he could borrow their glasses and then took off with them. Maybe not, I answered. No, you sure? The man said. Yes, I replied, whereupon the guy walked away without another word.
無事に新幹線に乗り、二人掛けの座席の窓側に座った。隣は空いていたので荷物を置き、おにぎりを食べて眠った。静岡あたりで肩を叩かれて起こされた。目を開けるとさっきの男が立っている。メガネ貸してもらえませんかと言う。嫌ですと答えた。男は何も言わず他のメガネを物色するような様子で後ろへ歩いていった。しかし、少なくとも数人いたメガネをかけた男性、車掌を含むには声をかけていなかった。後でニュースを検索したところ、2005年6月に川崎市中原区に住む29歳の男がメガネ強奪で逮捕されていた。若い男性ばかり狙って使用中のコンタクトレンズまで奪っていたその男の自宅からは、メガネ約130本とコンタクトレンズ散布されていた。
I boarded the bullet train and took an aisle seat. The window seat next to it was empty, so I put my bag there. I ate some rice balls and went to sleep. Somewhere around Shizuoka, I was awakened by another tap on the shoulder. I opened my eyes and, sure enough, there was the man from Shinagawa Station. "Let me borrow your glasses," he said. "No way," I answered. He didn't say anything, just walked off towards the rear of the car, casting his eyes about in search of other quarry. I noticed that he didn't ask any of the glasses-wearing men in the car. There were several, including the conductor. When I checked later on the web, I found that a 29-year-old man from Nakahara-ku, Kawasaki City, had been arrested for stealing glasses back in 2005. According to the report, though, he only robbed young men, sometimes even running off with their contacts. In his apartment, the police had discovered 130 pairs of glasses and 30 pairs of contact lenses.
午後10時ごろに実家に到着し、こたつに足を入れたら何か硬いものがかかとに当たり、強い痛みが走った。足を出してみると、足も押さえた手も血まみれ。後日判明したことだが、こたつの管状の赤外線ランプが割れて足に刺さったのだった。3日間は歩けず、文字通りの寝正月を過ごした。一月以上経つが、まだ完治しない。今年は厄年なので、元旦からこれでは相当に危ないと思い、厄払いに行った。帰りに引いたおみくじは今日だったが、これぐらいで勘弁してほしい。でもやっぱり、メガネを貸していたらどうなっていたか気になる。貸してみたらよかったかな、と思ってしまう。
It was around 10 p.m. when I arrived at my parents' home. I went into the living room to relax, sat down on the tatami, and slid my legs under the quilt covering the heated kotatsu table to warm them up. I felt my ankle strike something hard, and then a sharp pain. When I pulled my legs out, I saw one was bleeding. The hand I had instinctively clapped over the wound was also covered in blood. It turned out that the infrared bulb had broken, giving me a bad gash. I couldn't walk for 3 days, which meant that for me, the proverbial lazy New Year was the real thing. It has been over a month now, and still the leg isn't 100%. According to the zodiac, this is an unlucky year for someone my age, a yakudoshi. If this is the way it starts, I thought, I could be in for real trouble. So I visited a local shrine to try and remove the curse. I drew a fortune-telling slip on my way out. Sure enough, it said, bad luck. I hope I've already received my full quota of bad luck for this year. I find myself wondering how things might have been if I let the guy borrow my glasses. Maybe I should have just given them to him.
Hi, I'm Stuart Dybeck, and gonna read a poem out of Monkey Business. Real pleasure to be here. Mato Shabbat is a dear friend, great translator, and a terrific editor. It's called Nowhere. He walks as if stepping through a fallen ladder, tall enough to have once reached heaven. Today it reaches a line of boxcars, abandoned on the rusty tracks, to nowhere. Hay smolders from cauterized scars of bonfires. He crosses a charred trestle above a rapids of shards and startles a dog pack pulling at a ball of rags. When he tries reason, they bristle, bared teeth more menacing for their smiles. Eyes enlarged with rage rather than fear of the rebar he's picked from weeds and cocks like a bat until their circle tightens and he slashes so that at least air winds. And this dull like a bedspread snatched from a clothesline and shredded resembles a trembling child. Though if it were, he's sure the dogs would not have left it. The jolt. A shotgun blast scatters the pack. Bloody rags rise on woolly legs, bray, and totter into underbrush. He stands paralyzed, listening for the boxcars to couple again. But they stretch boundless, silent, undisturbed. If they moved, he'd climb aboard.
My name is Yoko. This is Brian Yoko, and I want to introduce myself. I play in a band called Hard Nips. Anyway, so I'm very big fan of Monkey Business. I found this when I was in Japan. I'm big fan of Japanese musician Kenji Odawa. I think he wrote something about Monkey Business. So I found this book. I really like it. Then I found this. Actually, I went to the McNally Robinson. It's the event was there last March. So I just so excited and. I just met Brady, and I want to introduce his Keitai Shosetsu. So it's very short, so you can read on Keitai screen. Keitai is a cell phone in Japanese. So I wanna read in Japanese, and he gonna read in English. And the title is Young Love is Everywhere. ここにもそこにもヤングラブ。地下鉄に乗っている女の子がにっこり笑う。女の子はヘッドホンで音楽を聴いている。今かけているのは一番のお気に入り。ここにもそこにもヤングラブ。新人ガールバンドのブルーポピーズである。女の子は目を閉じて、見知らぬ通勤客に囲まれているのも忘れ、その伝染力あるリズムに合わせて腰をピクピク動かす。入り口付近から眺めていた男がそれを見てニヤッと笑う。男もいい気分になってやはり腰をピクピク動かす。初老の女性が雑誌から顔を上げる。全く近頃の若い子と来たらと女性は思いニヤッと笑う。そして座ったまま置いた腰を動かす。隣に座った中学生2人が気まずそうに引きずった笑いを浮かべる。それから2人とも飛び上がってピクピク動き出す。じきにもう地下鉄の車両全体がピクピクピクピク動いている。列車が次の駅に着く。いい気分で腰をくねらす人々がどっと降りて、いい気分を抱えたまま散っていき、いい気分はいい気分の常として広がっていく。瞬く間に階段でも駅構内までもリズムに合わせて腰がくねりピクピク動き、そのままどんどん広がって込み入ったドアを抜けて街へあふれ出ていく。慌ただしい巨大な都市全体が通勤途中、ブルーポピーズ、ここにもそこにもヤングラブのリズムに合わせて揺れている。遥か下で地下鉄の車両は闇のトンネルを疾走していく。女の子は依然目を閉じて、ここにもそこにもヤングラブを小声で口ずさんでいる。だから彼女は一連の展開にも気づかぬままである。でもそれでいいのだ。とにかく楽しい時を過ごしているのだから。 Thank you.
Yoko is the lead singer of a super rocking band called Hard Nips, based in Brooklyn. And I'm a big fan of one of their songs I told you just from backstage called Oblivious in Babylon. It's all on YouTube, so check it out. This is a story, Young Love is Everywhere, from a book of Keita Shusetsu cell phone stories that I wrote for publication over Japanese cell phone internet. That was then brought out as a book and all translated by Shibata-san in Japan. So this is called Young Love is Everywhere. A girl in the subway smiles. She listens to her music on her headphones. The tune playing now is her favorite, Young Love is Everywhere, by the new all-girl band, Blue Poppies. The girl shuts her eyes, and despite being among strangers on their way to work, she twitches her hips to the infectious rhythm. A guy grins at her, watching from the door. He feels happy, and he twitches his hips too. An elderly lady looks up from her magazine. These kids, she thinks, and she grins. She moves her hips, her old hips, in her seat. Two schoolboys next to her sneer in embarrassment. Then they hop up and start to twitch. Shortly, the whole subway car is twitching away. The subway train arrives at the next station. Many hip-happy folk pour out and take their happiness with them, and it spreads as happiness will. And in a matter of a moment or two, hips are shaking and twitching in rhythm on the stairs, out into the station, spreading wide through the crowded doors, out into the streets. The whole vast, busy city is swaying on its way to the work, to the rhythms of Young Love is Everywhere by Blue Poppies. Way down below, the subway car speeds on through the dark tunnels. The girl has her eyes still shut, singing Young Love is Everywhere to herself. And so she misses the whole thing. But so what? She's having a fine time anyway. Thank you.
Try to run down some of the people you just heard. We had to obviously get people on and off fairly quickly, so it probably wasn't entirely clear who you were seeing at every minute. The band that played, as I told you, a number, they're coming right back now to play another number for you, is Neo Blues Maki. And the first two folks you saw on stage after them, Motoyuki Shibata and Ted Goosen, who are the founding editors of Monkey Business, in Japanese and also in English. Thereafter was Matsusugu Ono and Ted Goosen reading the, I think it was the Monkey Story. Kelly Link followed them. Then Tomoka Shibasaki with Ted Goosen. And then followed that with Stuart Dybeck. And of course, Yoko Sawai and Barry Yurgrau. So I'd like to give a round of applause to all of those folks. We have copies of Monkey Business International for sale out in the lobby, and given that the performers you just heard are all here and are all included in the publication, they will be circulating out there to sign books for you, also to answer questions or engage with you if you'd like to talk to them. The books are right outside the door, and the performers are all right here. I should mention another project which one of our good friends David Karashima and Elmer Luke were involved in, which is a book called March Was Made of Yarn. These are stories by primarily Japanese authors in the aftermath of 3/11. And that book is also available. I'm not sure if it's here tonight, but it is published and available. So both of those worthy projects, if you're interested in learning more about what's happening in Japan today from authors and poets and even manga artists, as I said. So with that in mind, to close us out tonight, once again, the sushi roll of soul. Gina's band, Neo Blues Maki. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Roland. Thank you, Maki, for having us. The next song is called Kita no Yadokara, which is a song by a famous Enka singer, Miyako Harumi.
Okay, so we have a few more minutes. I'm going to ask these guys to play one more for us. But don't let the quality of the music distract you from the quality of the literature. They're one and the same, so keep in mind the books are available, and in the next 10 or 15, we can do some signings and meet and greets if you step out to grab a book. So other than that, I'm going to let the music carry us home. Thanks a lot again for coming out. Thanks.
You know.
Everyone involved. So that'll be a book court in Brooklyn Wednesday night. So please come out and join us again before everybody has to go home. Thanks so much for coming tonight.